Let's now discuss this with environmentalist Rodney Galicia. He's the executive director of Living Laudato Si Philippines, an environmental NGO promoting the groundbreaking encyclical of Pope Francis on the environment. Mr. Galicia is also the former Philippine branch manager of the Climate Reality Project. Good morning, Rodney, and thank you very much for joining us again on the program.
Hi, Christian. Thank you very much for contacting us and the opportunity to join in the conversation about Manila Bay. And we've been conversing this since last year, and we have another sensitive issue at hand which needs to be clarified and to be discussed further.
We need to hear voices coming from groups like yours, especially with the assurance coming from the Department of Environment and Natural Resources. I think you heard the assurance coming from the Undersecretary, Ben Antiporda, that they've studied this and they assured the public that there's no hazard to health or the environment given the materials that they put in at the Baywalk area of the Manila Bay. But what do you think? Is this true? There are no dangers?
Well, the burden of proof would be carried by the DNR, Department of Environment and Natural Resources, and of course by the Environmental Management Bureau. The burden of proof should be, of course, they will have to explain that the constituents, the people, the organizations seek actually where's the study, where's the feasibility study, if they really wanted us and the civil society to understand what they're doing. Transparency is the most important thing that they need to do. Where is the hydrological study? And as far as I know, in the General Appropriations Act, in that kind of projects, there's a need for a disaster risk reduction and management assessment, you know, the risk assessment of every project. And as far as we know as well, we have a 9-point assessment of that with Living Laudato Si Philippines. Our team looked at it on different angles. One number one, of course, is the sensitivity. We all know that many projects for the 2020 General Appropriations Act and a lot of departments and agencies of the government, their projects and the budget for their projects were actually realigned to COVID-19 pandemic expenses. And as far as I know, because I sit down also in the Regional Development Council of Imaropa, as far as I know, many important projects as well were not pushed through because of the realignment of funds. And now, and according to DNR, we all know that we commend the Department of Environment and Natural Resources for addressing this and for following the mandamus, you know, the command of the court that they need to pull in resources and all their efforts to rehabilitate Manila Bay. But the thing is it really being sensitive to the challenge of this time of pandemic? Meaning to say, you know, we have a lot of necessities when it comes to food, when it comes to jobs, among others. And then the main objective is to beautify Manila Bay for tourism and for swimming. And at the end of the day, we need also to look deeply into the ethics of pushing through with that project.
Okay, so that is the big picture. But how about the idea of nourishing the beach? That's what they're claiming. Of course, we know that this is a big project coming from the national government. And of course, improving the waters of Manila Bay is very important, especially given the order coming from the Supreme Court. But do you actually rehabilitate the Manila Bay this way? Is this the right way to do it?
Prioritization is important. We have the 2017 to 2022 operational plan for the Manila Bay Coastal Strategy. We need to go back to that document. Now, where is the nourishment project component there? I have reviewed the OPMBCS, but at the same time, the non-coverage component of not releasing actually environmental compliance certificate. There are projects here that are not allowed or not permitted to, and there are projects that, okay, this is not covered by the environmental impact system. I have reviewed all of this, and I haven't seen any kind of project which will not fall under non-coverage it's so vague, Christian. It's so vague.
So in short, just to make this clear, just because this is a DNR yes. project, it doesn't mean that they are exempted from that requirement?
That's right. That even smaller projects in the provinces that needs earth moving, among others, they always seek, you know, where is your environmental impact study? And with this case, with the Mandamus case, with the pending rehabilitation of Manila Bay, with the Supreme Court action, this is a very sensitive issue. And then they will tell us, oh, there's no need for ECC there. There's no need for environmental impact system or to study, or even feasibility study, hydrological study or whatever. Even a lot of restaurants, a lot of facilities were closed by the Department of Environment and Natural Resources because of the Mandamus case of the Supreme Court. And if there, it's not covered by the environmental impact system, then the thing is, they need to show to the public their feasibility study. They need to show to the public that why is it that there's a need for nourishment? What is to be nourished in that part of the bay? Why is it only 500 meters, but not all? And I agree with architect Palafox. Manila Bay is not only Baywalk. It's Cavite, Bataan, among others, and Bulacan, etc. So why focus on that 500 meter portion? But in fact, you've got a lot of things to do. Focus on the root cause of the pollution in Manila Bay. It's prioritization.
Okay.
And it is actually empathy to the victims of the pandemic, and at the same time to the people who were affected by joblessness.
Most definitely. But looking at this specific project, it's very costly, $397.9 million. Can you imagine how huge an amount that is? But if you put so much money in this particular project, what benefit does it actually give? Or does it give any benefit at all? Given the overall program for the Manila Bay rehabilitation?
Yes, Christian, it is a big question. In their feasibility study or risk assessment, there should be a cost-benefit analysis. With this kind of sensitive project, a cost-benefit analysis is necessary so that we'll know after a year or after 2 years or 5 years, would tourism be contributory, you know, the funds that will come in, or would it contribute to the gross happiness product of those people in Manila Bay, not only focusing on the people who would like to swim there at the Baywalk. There are many people who would like to go out from Manila and go to Bulacan, to Cavite, and Bataan, and do their swimming there. But when we need to focus more on the source and the root cause of pollution in Manila Bay. Beautification usually happens, or polishing, after you solve the root cause of the problem.
And they haven't done that?
Well, there are a lot of things to do. The esteros, the factories, okay. among others. And okay. of course, the ships there will be dumping a lot of waste in
okay.
the bay.
So let's clarify the sequence here. Do you think this beautification project in itself is wrong, or that this can be done once the rehabilitation has been completed? Meaning the waters became swimmable.
Yes, that's right. And even mangroves, you know, you need to look at how you nourish the beach, or how you nourish the bay according to its own habitat before. That's okay. restoration. That's rehabilitation.
Okay, just to be clear, so that people won't misconstrue this this exchange of ours, do you think this beautification is actually needed, assuming that, let's say, the water has become swimmable? Or this in itself should not have been done?
This should not have been done unless there is scientific basis, and that we need to look at the data. We need to look at their study, their feasibility study. That's been in the media. That's been in conversation for the last 3 days. Where is the study? So I think, in fairness, of course, to the DNR, they're doing their best. They're doing their best. But the thing is, you need to be transparent. Give us and show us through a presentation or Zoom, for example, public presentation, that this is the plan and this is in accordance with the mandate given to us by the Supreme Court. And according to the plan, the 2017 to 2022, where's the risk assessment on climate change? Where is the cost-benefit analysis? And I think all of us will be happy if we know if we know that it's scientifically based, and if we know that there's risk assessment, and if we know that everyone will benefit from it.
Okay, what about the dangers of dumping, let's say, synthetic white sand, they call it dolomites. I mean, what are the dangers if you put such material on the Baywalk area?
Well, primarily, Manila Bay, if we have storm surges, if we have high tide coupled with strong winds, would it actually prevent storm surges? So we have a lot of solutions. You have the tetra pods, you have mangroves, etc. But would that really prevent storm surges? That's number one. Number two, dolomite as a synthetic sand, as they call it, a crushed rock, by natural processes, it is that the dolomite is not natural to Manila Bay. So if you put something that is not natural to Manila Bay, it's actually reclamation. Reclamation meaning to say you put something not really found there before. Well, it's rich nourishment according to the DNR. Well, they say that it will help. Solve the pollution problem because it may be, you know, it may be a catalyst for sipping in pollution or neutralizing. But the thing is, it's not natural to Manila Bay. That's the first. It's logical. You dump it there, meaning to say it may become a pollutant if it is natural, and the result is hazard. So I think, again, Christian, the burden of proof of proving that it is good for the beach, it is good for the marine ecosystem and sang, if we rehabilitate the former natural situation of Manila Bay, then I think we'll be clarified with that.
Can this also worsen the flooding in some areas around the Manila Bay?
Yes, of course. Because you put more, well, if they dig and put dolomite there, and you know the natural elevation will be there. If the natural elevation will be there, still storm surges will be there. So, what kind of mitigating measures that you need to do? If your focus is on storm surges, of course, dumping of dolomite there will not solve the problem.
Yeah, because I think a lot of experts have already warned that, simply put, this could easily be washed away or washed out into the sea, into the Manila Bay. So this could actually make the Manila Bay more shallow, and in fact, logically, that could worsen flooding. Is that correct?
Definitely.
Okay. Now, if that is the possibility, if those are the dangers that you've mentioned, don't you think this would actually go against the order of the Supreme Court?
It goes against the order of the Supreme Court. First, of course, does the measure, is it in the plan? Second, well, it's synthetic. It is absolutely not natural. It's not rehabilitation. If it is part of the nourishment of the beach, what will be nourished there? Because you haven't rehabilitated, you have cleaned it up completely yet. So I think there's a need for the Supreme Court to look deeply into that. And I hope Attorney Tony Oposa, who's one of the petitioners, one of the lawyers of the Oposa versus Factoran, I'm emailing him what kind of action that we need to do, because it's very vague and it may actually violate the mandate and the command of the Supreme Court to clean up Manila Bay.
Okay, just to refresh the memory of our viewers, you're talking about the Supreme Court order, the mandamus order, covering 13 agencies of government to clean up and rehabilitate the Manila Bay and make the waters swimmable again. So this is what the government has been trying to implement over the past several years. I think there are a lot of problems during the previous administration. And to be fair, under this administration, they're trying to push hard to actually rehabilitate this. But again, going back to our conversation here, is this the right way to do it? Because you don't want to end up adding to the pollution or to the problem of the Manila Bay, especially given the huge costs of this specific project. I mean, can you imagine how much this is? $397.9 million in the middle of a pandemic.
That's right, Christian. That's right. Well, it's not only the question of is it the right way to do. It may be the right way to do after everything has been done. But the other question is it the right time to do it? is it the right time to do it? Granted the fact that many important projects all over the Philippines in the region, the budget were realigned for the budget for the pandemic.
So
to address, yes.
In terms of sustainability here, I think earlier you mentioned the other alternatives that can be put in place to make sure that rehabilitation would be more holistic, right? For example, instead of focusing on beautification of a specific area, I mean, why not put up, for example, mangrove forests, I mean, other things that would be more sustainable and be more natural to the ecology. Let's talk about this.
Yes. By climate change mitigation, of course, in disaster risk reduction and management, they also need to actually coordinate with other agencies. No, we have mangroves, for example. Well, we need to study if there are indeed mangroves there before. But when it comes to disaster reduction and management, you need to prioritize. What's the biggest problem in Manila Bay? Pollution in Baywalk. Whenever you have storm surges, we have flooding. So if it is a priority, then we need to look at the mitigation measures for disasters reduction, for hazards. At the same time, if you look at the mangroves as well, then it can be a mitigation measure for storm surges, but at the same time, a carbon sink, a sequestration of carbon dioxide, GHG. Mm. So again, Christian, it will boil down to the kind of study that they did for this beach nourishment project. If they show that indeed it will promote disaster risk reduction and management, good. If it will promote tourism and it will nourish, what? So what would be nourished there? Only the beach or the sand or the marine ecosystem? What kind of marine ecosystem is that? So, Christian, I think we're open for dialogue. This is now one of the time or the best times for DNR to sit down and to explain their feasibility study, their program of work of the project, and where did they actually get the dolomite, what is the effect of mining dolomite in that area in Cebu, for example. So there's a need for a comprehensive study on that, not only telling people you tell us that it's not good. Well, you tell us that it is good, not us telling you that here is the proof or evidence that it is not good. Tell us, it's your responsibility to explain to the people that this is good, this is a mitigation measure for disaster, this is good for climate mitigation and adaptation. So I think, again, this is the biggest challenge for DNR. We are happy that DNR is doing their efforts to rehabilitate and nourish Manila Bay, but there's a need for transparency, there's a need for, again, empathy in this time of crisis.
But don't you think this should have been done much earlier? Because the project is already underway and they've already spent money on this project. I mean, if you're going to consult environmental groups, including yours, I suppose this should have been done. Was it even done in the first place? Were you consulted, for
consultation?
Example?
There is no consultation. The mere fact that the civil society are actually not really questioning, but constructively criticizing DNR and giving solutions, definitely we were not consulted. Mm. We were not consulted. We were also the ones who've been looking at it since last year, like January, December, December 2018, January 2019, February. Since then, no consultation. As for me, as far as I'm concerned, no consultation has been done on this project.
Finally, Rodney, what do you think of these arguments or justifications coming from certain government officials in connection with the beach beautification project, or what they call it, beach nourishment? I mean, coming from Secretary Harry Roque, he said this could actually be good for people's mental health if you see something beautiful there. And of course, the argument coming from the Environment Undersecretary that they're going to bring Boracay close to the residents in Manila, in Metro Manila, so they don't have to go to Boracay, to Palawan, to Bohol. I mean, some people are seeing this as something that's as skin deep. I mean, quite superficial, but what do you think?
It's impossible. the mere fact that the measures in solving the root cause of the problem is not there. Beautification will happen if we will already solve the root cause of the problem. The root cause of the problem is pollution. If the root cause of the problem is pollution, and you just put like Band-Aid or makeup there, it will not solve the problem. Manila Bay will not be rehabilitated if you put on your makeup first, not solving your inner wellness and health of the marine life, of course, of the ecosystem and the whole ridge to reef. What I mean is the whole ridge to reef, not only the bay itself, but the root cause, the people and the factories, the esteros, the people around Manila Bay, then I think putting makeup on will not solve the problem.
Which is true to the name of your group and consistent with the encyclical Laudato Si. Well, thank you very much, Rodney Galicia, for joining us this morning.